Oh, sweet glow cloud in the sky, what the huntokar are you wearing? No, 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 do not speak to me. If Hot Topic and Spencer's gifts consummated the most unholy of unions, and the cursed offspring carried a line of novelty steering wheel covers that could Voltron together to become a business suit, it wouldn't look half as horrible as that. I mean, do you come with the volume control? Is that a Dayglow Poet shirt? What were you doing this morning? Participating in a concert to see how many manservants you can wave off in irritation? And where? Where did you find a polar bear to skin and turn into that coat? You really need to do something about that hood because it looks like it's almost finished swallowing you whole. Also, no bow tie should be that color of paisley. It looks like the type of tie that you just tear off and the entire suit comes with it, like you're some sort of stripper. Here, look at what I'm wearing. Here, look. I bought the same identical suit 8 times. A white zoot suit. Each and every one. Classic. Timeless. Professional. Pleats so inhumanly crisp. You could use them to keep your vegetables from wilting. See this hair? It's so sharp you can cut cheese. That's why I get invited to parties. People swipe blocks of cheddar in my general direction and bam! Slices of dairy products so thin they can only be compared to the translucent gossamer wings of a scarlet dwarf dragonfly. True, most of my conversations at parties seem to revolve around explaining how I'm not actually part of the catering staff, but it's about the destination, not how you get there. Now hurry home and change, because the show's about to start, and I am not going to stare at you for the next 5 hours.
My fellow Americans, I'm pleased to tell you today that I've signed legislation that will outlaw Russia forever. We'll begin bombing in 5 minutes.
The klaxon begin to wail.
To another installment of Good Morning Night Vale Tonight. I am your host, Robert York, taking you through the midnight hour to the early morning as you listen to the radio station. Tonight we'll be starting with an announcement from station management. Station management is from another part of the country called Innsmouth Massachusetts. They come from an old family that's been there since the founding of this nation's oldest university, Miskatonic U. MU. My old alma mater. Home of the battling cephalopods. Go pods. I got in a scholarship, you know. I spent many a semester working in food service to help pay for my tuition. It was my job to run down I'm getting off topic. Where was I? Management. Right. Once a katun, or 7,200 days. Management's family gets together and they have their katunial family reunion. As it turns out, management is the host this time around. So management would like to welcome their family from across the globes. Relatives are coming in from as far as the Naparapo branch of the clan in Akasaki, Japan, all the way to the inbred cousins of Weirton, West Virginia, and all points in between, and from the space between points, and from the unnatural angles that the sane cannot perceive. So people of Night Vale, if you are on the streets tonight, please extend our town's newest visitors a warm, traditional Night Vale welcome by pointing at them and exclaiming, "Interloper," in a long, drawn-out moan that sounds like it's being pulled from your lungs rather than being a voluntary response. And if you're not on the street, count yourself lucky. Huddle in your beds and try not to breathe. Avoid producing movement or heat, for if our visitors detect either, they may mistake you as prey. Ha ha, I'm just kidding. There's no chance they'll make that mistake. We're all prey. So from all of us at the station, to all of Night Vale's newest visitors, welcome to
Censor due to copyright.
And now, letters from the listeners. Hey, Rob. I love your show. My name isn't important, but I have a problem. I currently work as one of the traffic cops who you see on the side of the road. We're working tirelessly to instruct passing drivers what to do using semaphore. Recently, I got into an argument with my supervisor about the proper way to handle the flags. I'm starting to have second thoughts about the position I took. I have this tendency to dig in my heels even when I'm on shaky ground. So I figured I'd give you a call before I finish digging and ask, what is the proper way to handle a flag? I need to know if I should chisel an apology or some sort of sarcastic retort on this tombstone. I'll take my answer off the air. First of all, thanks, listener, for your kind words. And yes, I happen to be quite the expert on flag etiquette. I always carry around a little cheat sheet with me that just because. I mean, after what happened last Flag Day, who wouldn't want to have a couple of notes, you know what I'm saying? So, the Night Vale flag is a statement of pride. Pride in our community. Pride in things that nobody shall acknowledge or speak about. Pride in the utterly vulnerable status of our internal organs. As such, it's imperative that we show our flags the respect that the prophecies inscribed in them demand. Here is a list of do's, don'ts, and anti-don'ts. The flag should be raised briskly and lowered painfully. The flag should not be part of a costume or athletic uniform. The flag should never be used as a receptacle for receiving, holding, carrying, or delivering anything. When used as part of a marching ceremony, your flag should always be held on your left. The flag should always be flown at full mast, except on the following days: on Memorial Day, Boxing Day, Dentist's Day, and any day the brownstone spire is vibrating at a pitch of high C, your flag should be flown at half staff. On Lazy Day, whatever. On Panic Day, Chanting Day, or Harvest Day, leave it at the height that looks like you were dragged away kicking and screaming before you could finish. On Flag Day, Tweed Day, Thursday, or any day the brownstone spire is unleashing a cacophonic din of random oscillations, the flag should never be flown. When putting the flag to half staff, always raise it fully to the top first, briefly, before lowering it to the proper height. This may buy you some time. Machine wash only, starch thoroughly. Do not burn a flag unless you seek the ire of the elder ones. Frayed and damaged flags should be disposed of by burning. If a flag passes you in a parade, only salute if you are in uniform. Otherwise, place your hand over your heart. If you do not bring one with you, politely ask someone next to you if you could share. If flown at night, the flag must be properly lit. If flown during the day, the flag must be properly dark. Finally, flying the flag at different times and in different ways and in different manners have different meanings. Learn these well, or you may find yourself making placating sacrifices. Upside down indicates physical distress. Inside out indicates emotional distress. Sideways indicates no thank you. The other sideways may be interpreted as a sign of aggression to certain mammals, especially badgers. Backwards indicates that you are passively aggressively letting your neighbor know that you are unhappy with the state of his lawn and would kill him to use a rake. Seriously, you are bringing down the property values because everybody on the block thinks you're a hobo. I don't care if you work nights and burst into flames when exposed to sunlight. Hire one of those arachnids who hang around the Home Depot all the time. They work for flies, and if they give you too much lip, just call Immigration and Customs Enforcement. I did that when one of them started dating my daughter. Problem solved. I hope this quick and easy guide to the care and feeding of flags was of use to you. If you haven't been feeding your flags, they can get quite ravenous. Even as we speak, one has broken out of its cage. It's skirting across the floor, coming closer. Closer. Oh, so close now. Now would be a good time to wake up, listener. You need to wake up. Those aren't blankets you are struggling to pull off your face. You are not tangled up in the sheets. You need to wake up. You need to wake up right Oh, well. This has been Letters from the Listener. And now a word from our sponsors. This installment of Good Morning Night Vale Tonight was brought to you by Vicks NyQuil Cold and Flu Medicine. NyQuil. The nighttime sniffling, sneezing, coughing, aching, stuffy head, fever, hair standing on the back of your neck. What are those shadows doing? Margaret, get the children out of here. Just go. It's too late for me. Oh God, it's got me. It's starting with my legs. For the love of all that is holy, just kill me. Why can't I die? This is the greatest of pains, so you can sleep while you're being eaten alive. Medicine. NyQuil helps you get your Z's. This has been a word from our sponsors. Listeners, the Director of Emergency Press Conferences, Pamela Winchell, just called an emergency conference and made the following announcement. There is an outbreak of some sort of disease that manifests as long tendrils that grow from the back of your head, giving you what has been termed by the Greater Night Vale Medical Association as Eldritch Mullet Syndrome. Symptoms of EMS include a strong need to start playing a string instrument, hair that can taste the back of your neck, and the urge to finance a tattoo. At which point, a small group of blue-skinned Oni appeared and summoned forth a whirlwind of chains, flames, and hooks that lashed out at Pamela Winchell with the intent of dismemberment. However, before the deadly manifestation made contact, she collapsed into herself before exploding into a cloud of 1,000 darting shadows. Each shadowy fragment reformed wherever it landed into various forms of vermin, including, but not limited to, bats, rats, oxen, cigars, antiques, and the occasional malnourished Sean Penn, the majority of which quickly surrounded her attackers. The Japanese demons, recoiling in fear, murmured that maybe it was finally time to go home. Something about how late it was getting, followed up with comments about needing to work in the morning. Then they all vanished in a flash of speed lines and cheap animation. And now the Children's Fun Fact Science Corner with special guest, Agent R. Dacted. Despite the fact this is being broadcast at 3 a.m. in the morning, when most children are fast asleep, you should in no way think of this as a secret-coded message.
A's for the tracker. Apache, he said. Not quite as embarrassing now that he's dead. B's for Big Rico's. Best under the sun. No one does pizza like Rico. No one. C's for the council with crowns of soft meat. They're off on a clearly pre-scheduled retreat. D is for Dana, or maybe her twin. It's hard to say which of them managed to win. E is for Emmett, or Ernest, some claim. It's hard to remember him, even his name. F is the faceless old woman who roams, unseen, just behind you. She lives in your home.
G is the glow cloud beneath whom we flail. All glory, we cry unto it, all hail.
H is for Hiram and all of his heads, a literal dragon who ran from the feds. I's for the interns who've come and who've gone. We send our condolences, then we move on. J is John Peters, the farmer, you know. Folks love the invisible corn that he grows. K is for Kevin, who worked here a while. Beware of the lies hiding under his smile. L can be found on the edge of the town. It's old Larry Leroy. He's always around. M is for Marcus, the town's richest man. I'd tell you what happened, but I don't think I can. N is for Nazar, the school's football coach. His tongue's pretty creepy. I wouldn't approach. O's old woman Josie, whom we dearly missed. Surrounded by friends who do not exist. P is for Pamela, Mayor No More. A press conference chief with surprises in store. Q is a question you never will voice. No shouldn't about it. You don't have a choice. R is for Roger, who paid with a spine. It bought him a condo and terror sublime. S is for Steve. I'll try not to rant. He once saved my life by... No, sorry, I can't. T's for Tanika, that lover of books. She's already found, so don't bother to look. U's for the people just under Lane 5. They'll only rest when we are no longer alive. V's the vague yet menacing team that works for the government, so it would seem. W is for worms. Ellipsis, no caps. If you can't find your dog, it's the pellet that yaps. X has been cancelled, we're sorry to say. There's nothing to see here, so be on your way. Y is for you, it just so turns out. You're sometimes the one that the story's about. Z is the sound once you've turned out the light. So I wish you all a good night. Good night, Night Vale. Good night.
This has been the Children's Fun Facts Science Corner, brought to you by a vague yet threatening government agency. The following episode of Town Talk was pre-recorded and edited for time. It is vowed that the birds are psychopaths, lying in wait for the souls of the dying, and that they time their eerie cries in unison with the sufferer's struggling breath. If they can catch the fleeing soul when it leaves the body, they instantly flutter away, chittering in demonic laughter. But if they fail, they subside gradually into a disappointed silence. Hello, listeners, and welcome to another episode of Town Talk. This week, we are interviewing the arachnid American activist and head of the Tarantula District's Better Business Bureau, Witsy Bitsy. Thanks for coming on the show, Miss Bitsy.
Thanks for having me. And please, call me Witsy.
Will do, Witsy. Please, call me Rob. So, we had some issues between your organization and the radio station a while ago due to miscommunication. I'm so glad you took the time to come on the show and clear things up with us. Again, I'd like to formally condemn our part in the recent commercial that was made in rather poor taste. The Ace Hardware Franchise Conglomerate, LLC, also released a statement that it deeply regrets its involvement. I hope that you'll accept our most heartfelt apologies.
My organization is more than happy to accept the apology on behalf of arachnid Americans throughout Night Vale. Understand that too long have various arachnids accepted the frivolous use of the word spider. We hope to educate the population of Night Vale, and I'm sorry. I'm just not comfortable sitting here. Do you mind if I weave a web?
Not at all. Please, make yourself comfortable. I hope you do understand that Night Vale has only the best of intentions. I mean, just look at the, admittedly, poorly named Teach a Spider to Read, Stop the Madness program.
Ha! Town Council propaganda! You have no idea what the real story was behind that government boondoggle.
Excuse me? I thought it was rather successful. I mean, there was that TV spot. What was it called? A Tom story?
Double ha! Tom wasn't even from Night Vale. He was a paid actor they brought in from Europe. I think he's from Svitz. I mean, it's freaking obvious from the accent. There's no record of him at Night Vale High, no grades recorded, much less any evidence of him showing any dramatic improvement. And I've never heard of a summer Shakespeare act-a-thon, have you?
Well, that's a lot of things I never heard of. Do understand, I'm very good at remaining ignorant. It's almost mandatory, what with the events that took place in Pontypool.
Oh yeah, right. Forgot about that.
For the best, I'm sure.
Well, the program was a complete sham. All the funding was funneled into various forms of meat.
Like a front company that produces meat?
No, it just was bundled up and stuffed inside slabs of beef.
Ah, well, let's get back on track. I took the liberty of clearing the next 3 hours for you so you can talk about whatever it is on your mind to your heart's content. It's the least that we can do here at the state. Breaking news! The outbreak of EMS is spreading rapidly. Infected citizens all over Night Vale are wandering the streets with glazed looks over their eyes, moaning a single word over and over. The Sheriff's Secret Police has started up a NASCAR track that circles the dog park, much to the chagrin of the hooded figures within. When the Sheriff's Secret Police Happy Fun Time Citizen Pacification Armored Personnel Carrier crashed through the walls of the dog park, the hooded figures weren't that upset. It was when the driver drunkenly demanded the hooded figures be his pit crew that they got a little huffy. Everywhere, citizens are pushing their vehicles into their front yards, removing the tires, putting said automobile up on cinder blocks, before proceeding to convert them into stills. On the upside, banjo sales at Louis's Music Shop are through the roof, which is rather surprising because Louis hasn't had a roof ever since the place burned to the ground. Night Vale, it looks like this could be the end of culture as we know it. As I speak, intern Phil has used about 14 cans of Aquanet to make the largest beehive hairdo I have ever seen on a man. Interns Agnew and Calhoun are wondering about shirtless in dungarees as they work on forming a jug band. No one is safe. There is nowhere left to turn. Who can we call upon now in our darkest hour? And now listen and learn with Mr. Science.
Today we are going to be talking about a common household problem. The manifestation of hateful sludge dripping down the exterior walls of your home. As we all know, hateful sludge is the physical manifestation of all the sins that no longer can be contained within your frail human form. You can expect for hateful sludge to continue to manifest until you take the following corrective measures. Molt. Now, I'm sure that you tried the obvious first, but it never hurts to start at the beginning. Just to be sure, even if you have already molted, do it again. Maybe you didn't do it the right way the first time. Feed a single potato chip to a cat. Again, I'm sure you tried this. But did you use an oven-baked Lay's original chip? The cat in question, was it a Russian blue properly crossbred with a Siamese so that its harsh vocalizations were pleasing to Maui the time shifter? You may have skipped this step, what with the high fatality rate of this remedy, but you really can't move on to more extreme solutions until you've tried the basics. Participation in the ritualized hunt of the Sin Eater. Normally, this clears up most manifestations of hateful sludge, although in extreme cases, you may have to actually catch the Sin Eater and take an active part in the disembowel and re-embowel and unembowel process. Unfortunately, we just had this year's hunt for the Sin Eater, and who knows when the next one will be. Answer, Mr. Science, but I'm not going to tell you over the radio. You can schedule an appointment where we can discuss my fee for determining the next alignment just like all the others, you contemptible wretch. Seek a professional. If you are still having problems, then clearly you have been learning too much forbidden knowledge. You awful, awful person. I'm afraid you've gone past ritualized cleansing and appeasement and need to seek the help of a professional. Such a professional will surely betray your trust and report you to the hooded figures for the standing reward. So, if you're a do-it-yourself handyman, or if you have run out of the internal organs that can be harvested without perishing, you might just try some of the following advanced solutions. Pretend to be someone else. Since the hateful sludge cannot see, this is fairly easy to do. Just talk loudly about how you are now leaving and never coming back. Then stomp away. Return some time later and speak in a different voice. Ask everyone to loudly refer to you by a new name that begins with an M. Hateful sludge finds words that begin with an M quite pleasing. However, any slip-up and the hateful sludge will redouble its efforts. It may, in fact, make an alliance with the mildew festering in your shower grout. So while this has been known to work, I really cannot recommend it. Salt. You might not actually have hateful sludge, but demonic effluent. It's a common mistake, for demonic effluent is actually quite rare. If it reacts by releasing a screech that triggers memories of crimes you never committed, you got that effluent. This is easy to fix. Just search your home until you find your Mephistophelian house guest. Usually he'll be hiding under a couch cushion or in your pillowcase. When you find him, just look stern. Waggle a finger in a disapproving fashion while saying, "Okay, you got me. You got me good." Your cloven-footed friend will then look sheepish and leave. Mint enzyme cleaner. This stuff is amazing. It's got live bacterial cultures that break down offending organic material and physical manifestations of sin, yet leaves behind a pine fresh scent in the process. Remember to alternate between spraying the enzyme and distilled water between scrubbing. Now, it will take several days, but between enzyme and elbow grease, you should be able to clean up most minor outbreaks. Paint your house black. When all else fails, paint your entire house black. Or replace your aluminum siding with any of the patterns available from the new Jackson Pollock collection. It's a last resort, but if you are going to continue to be a vile miscreant that is truly unworthy of love, and you are on a budget, painting is the way to go. May I suggest you call up some friends and make a day of it? Make sure to offer your friends something to eat. You can't go wrong with the new
Ancient Grains
pizza from Big Rico's. Because nobody makes a slice like Big Rico's. No.
This has been Listen and Learn with Mr. Science. And now music news. Gwar, the heavy metal rock band, not to be confused with Psyamopsis tetragonolobus, the annual legume that Henry Ford used as a raw material to weave all his undergarments, arrived in Night Vale tonight. Well known for their elaborate and grotesque costumes, the core concept of the band is that they are a pack of barbaric interplanetary mercenaries. Their songs frequently involve hyper-violent imagery, as well as social and political satire. Apparently, there was some confusion because originally they thought they were being hired for a show, when in reality, they were being hired by time travelers to fight in the upcoming Blood Space War. Slave Pit Incorporated's collective response was, a gig's a gig, before being consumed in a flash of infinite darkness. Tickets for the concert will be made available whenever the paradox resolves itself. This has been Music News. Listeners, I barricaded the door to my subterranean broadcast booth. As I look out the window that gives me a view from the second floor of the station, I try not to think about it too much because it hurts my brain. But from here, I can see the spreading devastation as the town succumbs to EMS. Intern Phil's last act before he succumbed completely to disease was to determine that the cause of all of this was from none other than station management's relatives from West Virginia. I'm sure station management could do something about all of this, but they simply don't care. So I sit here, all alone, helpless, watching the events unfold as the pounding on my door starts to get louder and louder. The barrier simply cannot hold forever. There is no way that... Wait, what's that? Is that a Zamboni? Why, yes. It's a Zamboni driving through town. It's spraying water everywhere as it goes. What the hunter car is that driver there? Oh my, Glowcloud. It's Telly. He must have taken the Zamboni from the half-finished hockey rink and is driving it around town spraying people. And it seems like the Eldritch Mullets do not seem to react well to cold. Listeners, Telly the Zamboni driver has dusted off his old hair styling tools and is doing one heck of an impression of Ash from Army of Darkness. He's slicing off people's tentacle mullets with the skill of a surgeon, the speed of a cheetah, and the grace of an Olympic gymnast. As I speak, he is drawing quite a crowd of infected citizens. In fact, the pounding on my door has stopped as the infected withdraw to subdue him. Oh, Telly, you fool. You are one man against thousands. You're completely surrounded. You have no hope of possibly surviving this. And yet, there you are. A whirling dervish of scissors and hair care products. A pilgrim in an unholy land of poor personal hygiene and writhing split ends. Well, no matter the outcome of tonight, let everyone know that there is no finer cosmetologist in all the world. I could go home. The fire is gone, but I have a light. I want to come home. Even if you are no longer there. There's nothing to hold me anymore. But I can't go. Not as long as she's out there. I chose this course of action.
asked. You asked me to make a choice, and I didn't choose you. It doesn't matter. The same way it doesn't matter what happens tonight. What matters is the decision, the choice, to fight, to hope. At least I can still pretend to have hope.
What? I can't just sit here. I cannot let his sacrifice be in vain. He has drawn the attention of the infected, and I know what I need to do. There is only one organization in town that can stop this madness. The ones who caused it. Station management. If there are any uninfected listeners left in Nightvale, hear my words. I now go to station management to give them my resignation letter. I keep it on the wall behind me. I wrote it in felt-tip marker on the blade of a fire axe that was forged in the heart of a pulsar. I have many grievances with management, many slights and insults that I have endured, but now, this time they've gone too far. For you listeners, I go to end this madness. For Telly, I go so your sacrifice has not been in vain. And for Nightvale, I go, possibly for the last time, on my coffee break.
Give a man enough rope, give a man enough rope, and he can hang himself or not. That is the choice that he has got. He could wind up hanging down from a tree, or he could spin himself a life, that's what happened to me. Give a man enough rope,
give a man enough rope,
give a man enough rope,
give a man enough rope.
You hand two guys a pile of dough, one spends it fast,
one saves it slow.
You make a choice,
you make a choice,
up to you what you do,
up to you what you do.
This act ain't much, but through it I've met kings and queens, and I got to meet you. Everybody spins with a different twist. Some use elbow grease, some just flick the wrist. If you want to aim for a great big goal,
go for broke, just let her go.
Never let him see that there's effort there. You may sweat inside, but be debonair.
If you go for tears or you go for jokes,
shrug it off, it's nothing, folks. Give a man enough rope,
give a man enough rope,
give a man enough rope,
give a man enough rope.
It's good to set your sights up high, but don't expect pie in the sky. A guy might rush,
a guy might rush,
for that old pot of gold.
He
might not reach the rainbow's end, because my friend, the world is round, or so we are told.
So we are told. A guy could choose to run a bank.
A guy could choose to run a bank.
Another lives to till the soil.
Another lives to till the soil.
Or practice law or violin.
Or practice law or violin. Or maybe sell banana oil.
Banana oil.
One builds a barn, one writes a song.
One builds a barn, one writes a song.
One digs a ditch, one teaches school.
One digs a ditch, one teaches school.
But from the day I came along, I've always been a roping fool.
He's just a roping fool.
But I've had luck, and my rope made me free. I spun my fancy figures, wrote my columns, made my speeches, loved my horses, loved my family, spun a lovely life. That's what happened to me. Give a man enough rope.
Well, a lot happened on that coffee break. Let me get you back up to speed. The building was empty. Not even the ceiling squids were stirring. I climbed up access shaft B and made a beeline for station management's office suite. With a single swing of my resignation letter, I cleaved the door in twain. A light that was no color I've ever experienced before, poured out. I held my hand in front of my eyes to shield them, and through my fingers, I could make out the outlines of writhing masses. With my other hand, I pulled my resignation letter back with the intent of delivering it with maximum prejudice. I demanded an explanation for everything they had done. They replied, "August fools!" I lowered my letter and asked simply, "Huh?" At which point they produced a piece of paper. It was on their submit a suggestion form. It read simply, "Management needs to get a sense of humor." Apparently, management was deeply hurt by this. That's why they called their relatives for advice, and their relatives came up with a plan for an August Fool's Day practical joke. It was just their way of showing Night Vale that they did indeed have a sense of humor. You know, listeners, up until that point, I saw management as some sort of monolithic abomination. They weren't entities, but members of a group I had come to hate and despise. It's easy to do that when you stop thinking of someone as an individual and define them by the organization they are a member of. Stereotyping, we all do it. But it wasn't until that moment when I found myself staring into those blue, pain-filled, dinner plate-sized eyes that I finally understood that they were people-ish too. As soon as I stopped thinking about them as multi-tentacled horrors from beyond the pale that existed solely to torment me and sign my paycheck, and started thinking about them as Muffy, Buffy, Chad, and Chip, I realized they had feelings too. For them, this whole evening was just an attempt to fit in. And don't we all just want to fit in? I sheepishly apologized for hacking down their door, and they opened up. I had an honest and open dialogue with management, and they talked with me about how they were feeling disconnected. Apparently, they'd lost a lot after being banished to the 17th layer of the Shade Lands of Pain during the whole Strex Corp thing. You see, they aren't the owners. They're just middle management. They, too, have their bosses that they have to answer. And, well, they didn't just lose their jobs. They also lost self-confidence. They confessed that they'd been slithering around on eggshells ever since they got back. I talked about how disappointed I was that the interns got to fill in for Cecil on his vacation, and no matter how many times I asked, I kept getting denied. They told me flat out they don't want me associated with their flagship program. It's not that they don't think I'm good enough for the job. It's that it takes time to grow a brand. If I fill in for Cecil, I'll always be in his shadow. I can see their point. You know, it's amazing what getting things out in the open can do. We talked about the future of the station and got to know each other a bit. Did you know they're all members of Night Vale's country club? I didn't even know Night Vale had a country club. I asked them if I could, you know, join them there sometime. And they laughed, and 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 laughed. Laughed, 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 and laughed. That was a long 11 minutes, let me tell you. Finally, they calmed down, and as they wiped away the tears of bubbling pitch streaming down their eye stalks, they gave me a friendly wink. They said, "Let's see how your show's doing this time next year, okay? In the meantime, how about we all go out for coffee next weekend?" I said I'd look forward to it. After that, I explained how the joke was hard to get and that maybe they should start smaller next time. So they mind-controlled everybody to put everything back the way it was, and the eldritch mullets just fell away as everybody went back to bed, no words to wear, and with no memory of the night's events. They might be a little puzzled at waking up in the morning with a small pile of calamari all around them, but we'll burn that bridge when we come to it. As for Tully, he survived. Surrounded by the shorn locks of nightmares piled as high as the Zamboni he was standing on. You know, nobody might remember what you did this night, but I will never forget you. And that got me thinking. I realize that here at the station we're family, but Family isn't something that just happens. It's not something you are owed. It's something you have to build. I haven't been doing my part, but that's going to change starting today. You know, for the first time in a long time, I'm feeling good. Sure, my show isn't the greatest, and I only have 6 listeners, and I'm still operating out of a disused bathroom in the steam tunnels under the station, and my program manager is a severed monster head that is suspended under a zeppelin that floats around the room, occasionally honking at me when it's unhappy and is responsible for my performance review, and my budget is slightly lower than my shoe size. But all that aside, you know what? I think things are finally starting to go my way. And as always, let's have a good morning, Night Vale. Good Morning Night Vale Tonight is based on characters and locations from the podcast Welcome to Night Vale, which is the intellectual property of Commonplace Books. I hear they have a new show that starts tonight called Fear the Welcome to Night Vale. The background music was from stuff that came with my computer and various free use sound bites from across the internet and Disparation. I hear they're into stuff and thangs. This episode's coffee break was Give a Man Enough Rope by Will Rogers. Mystery Science was read by Cody Wolf. Agent Redacted was played by The Baker 808. And Witsy Bitsy was played by 600 Cake Days. I find it extremely odd that I have both a baker and cake as part of the show. The rest of the episode was written, produced, and read by me. Bob.